Please pray with me. Loving God, speak to us that we may hear the words you need us to hear on this day. Be with us as we seek to do your will, now and forever. Amen. The week before last, I was in Atlanta, otherwise known apparently as Hotlanta. Any of you been there? It was indeed hot, as it was here. It is the ninth largest metropolitan area in the United States, and its airport has been the busiest in the world by passenger numbers since 1998. I think by my math that's 20 years. Now between the airport and the downtown midtown section of the city is this, I can't remember if it's 6 or 8 lane highway, which even on a mid-afternoon on Sunday when we arrived was busy, solid, in both directions. And in fact, the traffic in Atlanta is so bad that we were told at the hotel that if we did not leave on Wednesday morning by 6:30 for our 9:40 a.m. flight, we weren't going to make it. It's a distance of 12 miles. It's like... Yet I was looking around from our hotel room, which was on the 25th floor, and we could look out from Midtown and we could see the uptown skyline, which is about 8 miles away from what I could figure out, and the entire area in between the two sections of the city is full of trees. And about a mile from the hotel in the other direction is an enormous park, which was full of people jogging all day long at 95. They're crazy in Atlanta. And at the edge of that park is this oasis of acres and acres of stunning botanical gardens. Now, if it were not for the fact that you could occasionally see the skyline peeking out from a couple of places in the garden, you would never know that you were in the middle of a city. So I read up a little bit on Atlanta's history to find out, you know, more about how this sort of happened. And I discovered that it was built in three sections as the city grew. And each section is filled with and surrounded by pockets of tree-lined streets, rolling hills, bungalows, Victorian-style homes, all sorts of very picturesque, suburban-like places. And in fact, I read it has at times been known as the city in the forest. It almost is as if Atlanta is two different cities. Which is exactly what I thought of when I read the passages for this morning. Two passages about the city. Now I'm wondering if any of you noticed anything interesting while the two passages were being read. Did you see any contradictions, anything in there that jumped out at you by any chance? You know, we preachers, we look for that sort of thing. So let's talk about Jerusalem in general. Now you know about Jerusalem and Zion, right? Zion is the mountain upon which the fortress of Jerusalem is built. And over the years, since biblical times, the terms Zion and Jerusalem have come to be used interchangeably. And all of it refers to the ultimate destination for the people. You may notice in many of our stories in both Testaments that everyone is always trying to get to Jerusalem. Now, when David was anointed king, he lived in Hebron, in what was the southern kingdom of Judah. But he soon united Judah with the northern kingdom of Israel, and he ruled over both from the city of Jerusalem, that place where everybody wants to be. In this passage from 2 Samuel tells the story of the beginning of David's reign as king. Now we remember little David, right? Little David, the shepherd, all those wonderful youngest of eight brothers. He's the least likely to become anyone of importance as anybody we've ever heard of. But he has served and he has fought well, and now everybody wants him to be king. And there are three things that are good to notice about David based on this passage. First, he reigned over Israel for 40 years and was in many ways considered the ideal king for Israel. And when he started in these verses, as it says, he was in favor with God, although if you know about David, you know that that did not always remain the case. Now second, when he moved to Jerusalem and began to rule from there, he named it the city of David. And third, the city was not his because he created it or built it. It became his because he conquered it. And that's the part which is interesting when we think about the implications of his reign over the nation. 1 and 2 Samuel tell one long story divided into two sections. And 2 Samuel has two themes. There's one about government and the importance of good government and the difficulty in keeping a good government. And then there's the theme about relationships among the people, relationships between the people and God, and about how all those relationships affect the nation as a whole. Now, if you've read the books at all, you know that there are a whole lot of struggles for power going on all the time through both stories, and personal struggles within leaders who just couldn't keep up. And you also know that David, who enjoyed a good, long, prosperous time as king, nevertheless made mistakes like everyone else. So, knowing all of this, what do you think about the fact that in this passage, Jerusalem, that holy place, by all biblical accounts, becomes the city of David? What does this tell us about David and his agenda and his opinion of himself and his approach to being king? To me, it says that David's view is that it is all about him. Let's face it, David has had a charmed career up until this point, did a great job taking care of the family sheep, killed the giant Goliath, he's been a successful general. Now all of the elders of the big important kingdom to the north have come to beg to him to rule. Now he's been pretty sure the whole time that he's the brains of the operation, and now the rest of the leaders are agreeing with him. Once he agrees to serve, he conquers Jerusalem by sending his men in through the back way, actually through the water pipes. And then he quickly installs himself as ruler over the newly united and very now powerful kingdom. David occupied the stronghold and named it the City of David. David built the city all around from the below upward inward, and David became greater and greater, for the Lord, the God of hosts, was with him. David became greater and greater, for the Lord, the God of hosts, was with him. According to the teller of this story, who gets the credit for David's greatness? God. The entire story is about how God looks in favor upon David. The elders say that God has named David as the shepherd over the people. And now the storyteller states with absolute certainty that David was great because God was with him. So why, now that the nation is united and all is going well, why is it now because of David? Did he do it all alone? Did he stand a chance at any of this with God's help and God's blessing? Would he have ever been anything other than a poet and a tender of sheep without depending on the strength and the wisdom that God gave him? David admittedly has been a pretty decent hero so far, but already he is showing signs of the king that he will become. One of the sources I read pointed out that Saul, who was the king before David, had a very hard time trying to wield his kingly power. He just did not have it in him to rise to the demands of the role. But already it appears that David is not going to have that struggle. David seems quite comfortable with the power. He's prepared to use it. He allows the elders to come and grovel in front of him. He disdains the people living in the city that he wants to inhabit. He makes it very clear who is in charge by naming the city after himself. And he establishes himself as the one to watch. David is very impressed with himself. He wants everyone to know it. His power is going to save the people. So back to my original question. Do you notice anything interesting about Psalm 48? based on what we now know about David and his history with Jerusalem. Look again at the first line. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised in the city of our God. Like the story in 2 Samuel, Psalm 48 is also about Jerusalem. His holy mountain, beautiful in elevation, is the joy of all the earth. Mount Zion, in the far north, the city of the great king. Same city, but in the psalm, who does it belong to? It belongs to God. Nowhere does the psalmist talk about David or how great he is. The great king, in capital letters, is not David. In this song about the city and its role in people's lives, the city is God's and so is the Lord. Now the Psalms are divided up into five books. Psalm 48 is the second book. And many of the Psalms were written well after the reign of David, who ruled from about 1000 to 960 BCE. Go back then, it goes backwards. In Psalm 42 through 72, which is the second book, there's a recurring message that the Davidic covenant has failed. And the people are feeling abandoned, or, in some cases, are actually in exile. And these psalms in this section are meant to offer hope to those who have been taken away from their homes, those who, once again, are trying to get back to Jerusalem. The city in this psalm is described in terms of God's connection to it. God is referred to as our great God, as our sure defense, as steadfast, as victorious, as just, as our guide forever. Jerusalem and its characteristics are seen as symbols of God. Its towers and ramparts and citadels are a sign of God's presence and protection. The mountain of Zion is God's divine protection, something that people can rely on forever. The psalm is written, if you've noticed, sort of as a tour of the city for pilgrims who are yearning to end their misery. First, they're told that this is the place where God lives. This is it. And then they're asked to reflect on how God is their strength and the towers are there to prove it. And then they're invited to walk around. Go around the mountain. Look at its majesty from every angle. Look at the power that it symbolizes. And remember that God is with them.
God tries to teach David again.
again and again and again for the rest of his life. And that is the message that survives through the Koranites who write about it. Jerusalem was indeed ruled by power, but not by any human power driven by any human agenda. It was ruled by God, and God alone was worthy of the credit. One of the unique things about Atlanta is that for a city in the South, it often does not act like a city in the South. It was founded as a transportation hub, not as a seat of local plantation owners, so its culture was different from the very beginning. Then it was almost destroyed during the Civil War, and when it was rebuilt, it was considered the progressive capital of the New South. And then what happened in the 1960s? It became the center of the Civil Rights Movement. And you can visit the church where it all began, where Martin Luther King grew up. And you can sit in this pew if you want, where Reverend Abernathy preached. And there's a Civil Rights Center and a Martin Luther King tribute and all of those kinds of things. And it was partly due, you learned, to the culture and Atlanta's unusual position as a different sort of southern city that allowed leaders like King and Abernathy to be nurtured and to be heard and to be followed. In the 60s and then the following decades, as it grew and continued to contribute, people described Atlanta as the city too busy to hate. What is important here is that no one calls Atlanta the city of Martin. The churches and the pulpits and the movements were not about King or about any one individual. Those preachers, the pastors, the protesters were not marching for their own glory. Atlanta was not called the city of God either. But it certainly was a city which allowed God's power and God's love and God's justice to grow and to reach out to a world which needed changing. And a city too busy to hate, let's face it, would certainly be what God would. David was in many ways a good king, but he was also human. He was very capable of making bad judgment calls, and he did. And why? Because he forgot that he was working for God and the people, not the other way around. He forgot that Jerusalem had always been and would always be God's place. He forgot that his power was temporary, while God's power is forever. He forgot who he was, and he thought that he was in charge. Maybe if David had had the benefit of the hindsight of the Koranites, he would not have made so many bad decisions. Like the people of Atlanta, who were too busy building a new kind of future to stay stuck in the hate of the Civil War, David needed to look beyond himself at the bigger picture. Because the picture belongs to God, as did David, and as do we. And that is a picture which all of us would do well to try to paint. Amen.